Closed captioning is brought to you by IT&E Life in Motion. KUAM News Headlines is presented by Calvo's Insurance, a legacy of trust. Serving Micronesia since 1938. Matson Navigation, serving Guam and Micronesia for 20 years. Cars Plus, Dodge Challenger, the undisputed champion. IP&E, fueling excellence. McDonald's of Guam, I'm loving it. And King's Restaurant, located in Tamuning and Dedado. Always open, always local.
A man found unconscious face down in Mingilao. The medical examiner ruled the case to be a homicide.
Closing arguments are scheduled for Monday in the Mark Torrey Jr. murder trial.
And police and medics rushed to a local middle school in the central part of the island after a report of fighting. Good evening, everybody. If you're watching us live on KUM TV or streaming us anywhere in the world on YouTube, thanks for tuning in, as it was a rather busy news day today, and we'll bring it all to you. And we've got the very latest with the Torrey murder trial in just a bit, but first, it was an early morning for the Guam Police Department, who was called to Mingilao after a man, Bree, was discovered lifeless near the roadside.
Chris Wilpaco has more details on the ongoing death investigation.
An early morning jogger was the first to the scene.
When she spotted this individual who was laying down by a concrete telephone pole just off the roadway of President Plain.
It was just before 6 a.m. Friday near Ron's Diner in Mingilao. The woman called on a nearby security guard who phoned police. The man was pronounced dead at Naval Hospital at 6:07 a.m. and a death investigation launched. Guam Police Department Criminal Investigation Section Supervisor for the Crimes Against Persons Unit, Officer Dennis Santos.
Right now there is an active death investigation that's happening at this point in time in regards to what we've developed so far. I can't comment on that at this point in time.
An autopsy concluded the man died from a skull fracture. According to Chief Medical Examiner Dr. Aurelio Espinola, the man also sustained lacerations to the face, on his forehead, between his eyes, and his upper lip, as if he had been in a fight. Ultimately, the medical examiner ruled the manner of death a homicide. The victim was identified as Gilbert Alvarez. Although no age was provided, he appeared to be in his 30s. Reporting for Guam's News Network, I'm Crystal Paco.
Did he actually suffer from an alcohol-induced blackout? That question put to the test after the prosecution had a forensic psychologist take the stand during day 15 of the murder trial against former police officer Mark Torrey Jr. KUAM's Nick Delgado has more as closing arguments are set to begin.
Accused murder suspect Mark Torrey Jr.'s memory has been in the spotlight, the former GPD officer confirming on the stand that he does not remember everything that happened the night Officer Bert Piolo was shot, but he did say in court that he didn't pull the trigger. The defense then calling up forensic psychiatrist Dr. Pablo Stewart to back Torrey Jr.'s testimony that he blacked out.
My feeling is that it's impossible to determine. You know, it's, you know, listening to Dr. Stewart, he spoke with some assurance. That was his finding.
Today, another twist in the case after the prosecution brings forth Hawaii-based forensic psychologist Dr. Dennis Donovan to speak out against Dr. Stewart's findings. Both doctors had been given mounds of discovery and evidence, as well as interviewed several people involved in the investigation.
I don't think or know that there was any way to establish a certainty that somebody had a blackout. The science is not there. There's an inconsistency between people having certain blood alcohol contents and a blackout. It is impossible to measure. It's based upon self-report.
Dr. Donovan also testified against Dr. Stewart's report that Torrey Jr. had post-traumatic stress disorder. He says he too spoke with Torrey Jr. and his findings determined he did not have the signs nor the symptoms.
I don't think it's possible to be certain. When I sat listening to Dr. Stewart, I wondered how he was able to reach such a level of assurance.
Defense Attorney Jay Ariola objected to having Dr. Donovan take the stand, arguing that he was not qualified to speak on the issue. It was during trial earlier this week the court learned that multiple doctors had diagnosed Torrey Jr. with PTSD following the July 2015 shooting. Still, Dr. Donovan said his conclusion showed otherwise.
You didn't think he had PTSD because he manifested it externally that he had been functioning properly.
I didn't get PTSD because he said he didn't have symptoms consistent with PTSD, and he didn't have signs consistent with significant problems.
And the prosecution's final witness, Officer Pillow's wife, Mika, who spoke about one of the last photos her husband took with their children.
So, my husband and our kids.
Who are the children here?
Jaden, Zayden, Alana, and Isaias.
The last bit of testimony the prosecution had the jury listen to before closing out its rebuttal witness list. Closing arguments are set to start Monday morning. Reporting for Guam's News Network, I'm McDelgado.
And now a story that was a huge item on KUAM.com today as police and medics rushed to a local middle school after a report of a riot broke out during lunch. Issa Baza reports.
Police cars, ambulances, and a fire truck were parked outside Antillon Middle School Friday afternoon as the Guam Police Department responded to a reported riot. Inside officers could be seen rushing to control the scene. The school underwent a procedure that lasted over an hour. Principal Agnes Guerrero.
They shut each other, but that was, you know, that was controlled immediately. There were staff around, and we mitigated.
We like to ensure that the parents that the students were safe. Although we went into shelter in place, it was to ensure that we wanted to contain the situation because it was during lunchtime.
Students involved in the fights were treated for minor injuries by the school nurse.
No students were taken by ambulance. There was no major injuries to any of the students.
Crews confirmed the incident is still under investigation by GDOE. She added it's a continuous effort for the department to work with parents, students, and stakeholders to teach students that violence is not the answer. Reporting for Guam's News Network, I'm Issa Baza.
Well, there, the corned beef culprits accused of stealing an estimated $400 worth of oxen palm and trying to sell the canned meat for $50 a case. Peter Jr. Nand and Frankie Roberto, who also goes by the name Diane Melanie Regis Roberto, are both charged with retail theft. The pair had been stopped thanks to the quick thinking of a store employee who wrote down their license plate as they tried to get away. Police were able to catch up with the thieves. They recovered the corned beef in the suspect's car as well. Both are each being held on $5,000 cash bail.
Well, a former candidate for senator and vice mayor has been indicted. A Superior Court grand jury indicted Derek Evan Hills, otherwise known to constituents as Derek Baza Hills. He's been charged with possession of a fraudulent prescription as a third-degree felony. Last week, Hills allegedly presented a fake prescription at a pharmacy in Tamuning for oxycodone. Staffers spotted the forged doctor's signature and called authorities. This marks the second time Hills has been busted for trying to obtain prescription pills. He'll answer to the charges on the 1st of March.
A trial date has finally been set in the protracted legal battle between DFS and the airport over a multi-million dollar concessionaire contract. As Nestor Lakanto reports, the sides will face off in Judge Arthur Barcinas's courtroom on May 22nd.
The long-running dispute began 4 years ago when the lucrative contract that DFS had held for 30 years was awarded instead to Lotte Duty Free. But in what was supposed to be a routine status conference hearing, opposing counsel provided a preview of what could be an explosive trial. DFS counsel Jay Srinivasan.
Lotte also changed its bid. It was a sealed, confidential bid that once you submit it, you can't change it. They submitted a bid, somehow got evidence of, we believe, DFS's sealed bid, and then changed their bid to come in just above us. On the minimum annual rent guarantee.
But Airport Counsel Jay Trinket counters.
The discovery that we are seeing that we've obtained from DFS is shocking and disturbing. But don't take our word for it. The documents, for the most part, are now in the public record. And DFS claims that that GIA is misrepresenting those documents. And we believe that the media and the public should go right to the source.
Trinket says they have seen documents that prove DFS engaged in repeated attempts to influence the airport contract through local media such as Sorensen Pacific and top government officials such as former First Lady Joanne Camacho.
DFS arranged with local media outlets who apparently owed DFS favors to do media stories on the airport and on Lotte back in 2012 based on what DFS told them without interviewing the airport and completely providing the story purely from DFS's perspective. We've also seen quite a bit of evidence showing that various consultants of DFS and former employees who are involved in the Guam government in various positions were secretly acting on behalf of DFS throughout the procurement, trying to get information from the airport, trying to influence the governor's office, and trying to influence other participants in the Guam government.
But DFS has allegations of its own about Lotte.
That they paid improper success fees to individuals. You're not allowed to pay a success fee in connection with an RFP. We talked about one individual in particular, Mr. Scrow, Tony Scrow, who we believe received such a success fee and may have funneled that to others.
That's not an issue for the airport. That's not something that the airport would normally have. And that's not an issue that should be the subject matter of this case. According to DFS, Mr. Scrow is paid by Lotte a lot of money. And if he's providing services for that money, then that's, from the airport's perspective, that's fine.
And both sides have differing versions of the role former high-ranking Lotte executive S.K. Lee had in not just the Guam deal, but the international business competition between the two companies.
I want to tell you about some of the things Lotte did and essentially confessed to wrongdoing, indicated other people were involved in Guam who were involved in this scheme to essentially give inducements, essentially funnel money to people to secure the bid.
What we've learned from DFS's documents, however, is that SK Lee had apparently developed a relationship with some people at DFS and for a long period of time collaborated with DFS, gave DFS information about Lotte's activities in various procurements and held secret meetings with DFS, not just about here in Guam, but also about a competition in Los Angeles that DFS ultimately won, beating out Lotte.
The sides continue to argue about access to documents and depositions that will be used in their long-awaited showdown set for the end of May in Superior Court. For Guam's News Network, I'm Nestor Leconto.
All right, my friends, we are going to take a break, but keep watching and keep streaming because Primetime continues right after this on KUAM.
There are more ways to experience KUAM news than any other source on Guam. Download the KUAM News app for your Apple or Android device for 24/7 news, sports, videos, weather, streaming with KUAM radio, and important news alerts. And stay connected at home with Guam's first app for Apple TV. All available now from the App Store.
Do you want to get discounts at local restaurants like Lone Star, PK, Capricciosa, Delmonico Kitchen and Bar, and Steakhouse, Tony Roma's, and lots more? 25% off on all natural and organic items at Payless Supermarkets daily. It's all part of Guam's largest rewards club, the Cavos Lifestyle Club. Join today for free as an added benefit to being a Cavos insurance customer. Just show your Lifestyle Club card at over 50 of our rewards partners to start saving more. It's just one of the ways Cavos Insurance helps you live a better lifestyle.
Hi, I'm interested in one of your new Samsung devices.
I have the one just for you.
We're increasing the amount of 4G LTE data on our new rate plans, giving people more of what they want to do more of the things they want.
So what do you think?
Nice.
Is your old ride letting you down? Then play Micronesia Mall's Rideaway Flyaway game and win three rides from Triple J Auto Group plus 30 flyaways to Manila on Philippine Airlines. Just present mall receipts to enter and win the 2017 Kia Soul, the 2017 Mazda 3 Sport, the 2017 Kia Forte, and instant prizes from Burger King and Foot Locker. Shop and win more cars, trips, and prizes when you play Micronesia Mall's Rideaway Flyaway game.
There's no place on Guam like Chuck E. Cheese's. It's tons of fun with so many games, and parties are a blast, where everyone has fun. Come and party at Chuck E. Cheese's Guam. Call and book your party today.
For 20 years, Matson has been an important part of our everyday lives. Bringing in the cars we drive, the food we eat, and the materials that helped build our homes, from caring for our land through the Adahi Itano program to generously supporting our local charity. Matson has contributed to the preservation and growth of our island. On behalf of those you've served throughout your 20 years on Guam, Jesus Ma'asi Matson.
Connect with KUAM News. Find us on your favorite social media platform. Follow us and stay in the know with Guam's news leader.
Welcome back. As part of their last stop in the territories, a congressional delegation from the Natural Resources Committee made their way to Guam, meeting with island leaders and military officials while also paying their respects for those lost during the war. Ken Quintanilla has more.
It's their last stop for the territories, and what better way to end their tour than here on Guam?
Since we're going to be dealing with those issues as the time goes on, we wanted to make sure we had a firsthand view of what's taking place on the territories.
And for Utah Congressman Rob Bishop, it was a view like no other. Not only did the Natural Resources Committee chairman and a visiting congressional delegation get to view the seaside villages above the Assen Bay Overlook, but they were also given a perspective of the issues facing Guam through face-to-face meetings with Guam leaders and military officials today.
So every stop along the way has been fascinating for us because of the kindness and hospitality shown to us. But also every territory, every island is a little bit different. The people are different. They're all wonderful and beautiful people, but each has a special spirit all of their own that is truly unique.
Congressman Bishop says part of the dialogue involves workforce, public lands, and expanding the economy. He adds every part of the United States also has an issue with H-2B visas, but for Guam, he admits, has special circumstances.
It is that your issues, especially in Guam, because you are so far away from the mainland and so much closer to the Asia, has a unique twist to it that you wouldn't find in Utah. Or to be honest, most of those issues come from South America and Latin America.
Meanwhile, Acting Governor Ray Tenorio used the visit to let the CODEL know about the importance of representation and voting not only for president, but also in Washington, D.C.
A vote from a representative on any United States citizen who has a delegate, a senator, a congressman or congresswoman in our Congress should have the ability to have that vote that was given to them passed on to the rest of our country and our representatives.
And for former Senator and Guam War Survivors Foundation President Frank Bloss Jr., he took this opportunity to address the CODEL about the war reparations for our war survivors. Fittingly enough, he did so at the site of the Assen Bay Overlook Memorial Wall, where over 1,800 names are displayed of those who died and suffered atrocities of the war.
I stand here in behalf of my father and behalf of the war survivors. Say thank you for your continued efforts, but it's not done yet. We're never going to forget what they went through, and we're never going to stop until that honor is finally given to them.
And as they participate in a wreath-laying ceremony, Congressman Bishop says it's an issue that's come before his committee many times.
The Senate has been a stumbling block, and to be honest, the Senate may still be a stumbling block in the future as well, but we'll address that one more time.
Congresswoman Madeline Berdalio says this is the first CODEL visit for the new year, adding the visit was at the request of Congressman Bishop. They depart Guam on Saturday. Reporting for Guam's News Network, I'm Ken Quintanilla.
Congresswoman Madeline Berdalio and former Congressman and UOG President Dr. Robert Underwood extend their condolences following the passing of former American Samoa Congressman Eni Falomaʻaega Jr. Berdalio said he was a true leader and thanked him for his tireless work on behalf of the U.S. territories. Underwood said Falomaʻaega was his mentor, colleague, and most of all, a true statesman for the Pacific. He went to school at Weddingale Elementary when his dad was stationed in Guam. He was also UOG commencement speaker in May 2010.
Well, leave is up for Superintendent John Fernandez, but will he return to work at DOE on Monday? Although the Education Board voted to reinstate him last week, he took a week of additional leave, during which time he discussed whether he'll be returning to the Department of Education with his family and his attorney. Board Chairman Peter Alexis Addis says Fernandez should meet with GEB members, including Maria Gutierrez, Dr. Ron McNinch, Mark Mendiola, and James Lujan, tomorrow to discuss the matter further. As of today, Addis says he's unaware that Fernandez has requested for any additional leave, meaning he may return as soon as the beginning of next week.
Sports is coming up next, but first, here's weather.
And Mighty, we're celebrating President's Day in a huge way. Nothing says boss like the Ram 1500, voted KUAM's best truck 2 years in a row. Take up the 4750R or the Jeep Wrangler. Take up the 2500R. How about the award-winning 2017 Hyundai Accent? Now $12,995. Or the redesigned 2017 Hyundai Elantra? Now $16,995. Visit CarsPlusGuam.com today for quick and easy financing. It's all happening right here at Cars Plus and Mighty, celebrating President's Day all month long. Cars Plus, driven by you.
Your love is like a fireplace. Your warm, sweet embrace. I want to see your face again. Your love is like a fireplace. Your warm, sweet embrace. I want to see your face again. Cause I'm caught up in the current of your love. And as you walk along the beach alone, to escape the wild storm, amplified by the musical tone, supplied by the John Dank Show. Oh, oh. Supplied by the John Dank Show.
Rockin' steady, I'm gonna put it on you, are you ready?
Caught up in the current of your love.
This is what precision sounds like. Sound dampening technologies like triple door seals that help keep outside noise out.
Talk about getting out of a tight spot.
Introducing the midsize pickup only GMC could build.
In more ways than one.
Canyon from GMC. This is the precision of professional grade.
Get $5,000 cash back on select 2016 GMC Canyon vehicles in stock. Visit AutoSpot GMC today.
KUAM Sports is presented by Triple J.
All right, BetNass, woohoo, Friday, like we do every Friday. You know how we do. Kick it off with our dial rent to own athlete of the week. Friday, woohoo, dial rent to own and Denito for athlete of the week presentation. Remember, this month, it's free brewery. My man, Peter here, our athlete of the week. This week, Aaron Judikba of Prebahau. Aaron, congrats.
Thank you very much.
And Peter with a special message for Aaron.
Congratulations on being Dial's athlete of the week. Who would you want to donate a check to?
KUAM Cancer Care.
Well, there you go. A great cause and a great fight. You know, we just had that Prebahau last week. Prove yourself. And this dude raised a lot of eyebrows, man. Debut fight. Really loving that style, bro, and you're able to put in a great fight. Just tell us real quick what you thought of your opponent and how you felt about your performance on Fight Night Friday at Prebahau.
Nothing but respect to Justin Tangulik, tough guy. And my performance, I felt did all right.
So what was your game plan going in there? Because, you know, Prebahau level, not a lot of guys have the gas to go, you know, three rounds, but you had plenty of gas in the tank.
Yeah, my initial game plan was just to stand up and keep it standing, but honestly, I got gassed in the second round, and yeah, I just kept it going by heart.
Let's talk a little bit about your training. I mean, you know, that debut, heck of a debut. Looked like you had a lot of experience in there. You're really comfortable in the cage. Talk to us about the kind of training, because I know you're just training out of the house in Windward, right?
Yes, sir. Just a lot of technique, drill over and over and over again. Not much sparring, just by myself, technique over and over again.
So I know you're working out like with stuff around the house, like something with tires or what?
Yeah, just set up some tires and yeah, just hitting it.
All right, so you know, after a performance like that, first fight, I know a lot of the fighters at Prebahau were like, whoa, who the hell's this kid, bro? And they probably want to, you know, match up with you. What's your next goal here in the Prebahau?
Just do the best of my ability and keep fighting.
You got an interesting style, man. I know that primarily a lot of stand-up there. Is the ground something you're comfortable at? And how were you able to get so good at your stand-up game?
Stand-up game, just a lot of experience from the street. Ground game, I feel all right. I'm not that comfortable there, but I'll get better.
Who are some of the guys that you look at? I mean, you're fighting at like 135-ish. Who are some of the guys that you kind of look at that, you know, you would want to go toe-to-toe with?
Doesn't matter who I fight. Fight anybody.
There you go. Fight anybody, bro. Right, our Dal Rento and Athlete of the Week, Aaron Jadikba, you look for him, man. Young man to watch here on the MMA circuit. Freebrewery here at Dal Rento. And remember, Peter, give us a little background. What exactly is Freebrewery?
So anything in our store is free for the month. If it's previously rented, you get 2 weeks free, provided it sets your payday. So there will be a proration if need be at the customer's expense. If it's brand new, it's 2 weeks free. It is excluding, though, brand new phones, brand new iPads, and our 55 and 60-inch TVs.
I'll tell you what, but it includes a whole lot of stuff. Freebrewery here at Dal Rento for Athlete of the Week presentation.
KUAM Sports Athlete of the Week is brought to you by
the FAS Athletic Club Mini Track and Field Challenge, held at Ukadoo High School tomorrow from 8 to 5. Big Brothers, Big Sisters of Guam been mentoring children to give them hope and a better life. And the Guam Track and Field Association is doing a shoe drive, collecting running shoes, any size, please clean in good condition. New socks, any dry fit shirts, water, sports drinks to benefit the FAS Athletic Club. A donation drop-off tent will be along the track side tomorrow at Ukadoo High. Middle school soccer, the Antelope Middle School Wildcats defeat Estumbo Middle School Dragons 3-0 at TZN. Riley Guzman scored 2 goals and Janae Terria once for the Wildcats. All right, tell you one thing about those FAS runners. Woo, they're fast. My name's Chris. You have a great weekend and a great Friday. Woo! And keep on shining, Guam. Adios!
You're about to go down, boy.
Oh, yeah? I'll show you, buddy.
How you like me now?
Bring it on.
I'll shut you up.
Oh, yeah? Come on.
When it comes to trucks, we have to put our foot down. Anything with a Ford badge on it has to crank the most power, the most torque, and get the absolute best fuel economy. Ford F-150, America's best-selling truck for 40 straight years.
That's it, boys. Fight it out for second place.
You know the mountains built for tough.
Turn the music up. Let me feel the beat. Let me feel the pulse. Oh, the sound so sweet. With the lights down low, let my cares just go. Got me in a trance. I just wanna dance.
Tourism is Guam's number one industry. It creates jobs and brings in spending. When a visitor comes to Guam, they spend their money on hotels, on transportation, on shopping, on dining out. They're happy they came to Guam. You know who else is happy? The hotel they stayed in and the bellman at the hotel. The tour bus drivers and tour guides. The stores they shopped at and the banks they used. The restaurant and the waitress. The supplier who delivered the ingredients, and the farmer who supplied the produce. From real estate to retail, tourism has a positive impact on every industry. When tourists pay taxes, it means locals pay less. Let's make sure our local economy grows so it becomes strong and healthy. Make Guam a better place to live, work, and visit. Support tourism.
I had a dream. I walked into a dealership, picked out a new car, gave them no money, and they're letting me drive it for free the next 3 months.
At Nissan Guam, your dream has become a reality during the premier New Year event. For the new year, you can drive away a new Nissan with no money down and not make a payment for the next 3 months. It's on the house, no money down. We make your first 3 payments. Just sign and drive away. For details, stop by Nissan Upper Cumont or log on NissanGuam.com.
All right, everybody, time for the Cold Stone Creamery Birthday Club. And shout outs tonight go to Damian James for birthday number 17.
Happy birthday to Melina Renee Robinson.
Also, happy birthday to Peter John Cruz Martinez and Orko. Maybe not a He-Man fan, but happy birthday, Orko.
Happy birthday to Devin John Hernandez from the family.
Also, happy birthday to Peter Mendiola. Hope you had a wonderful day.
Happy birthday to Mark Vincent Evangelista.
Birthday number 19, wishes go to Carlito TJ Rubrico Nicholas.
Happy birthday to Casey Italor and Davina Alvarez.
And also from your loving family, happy birthday wishes to Irene Mesa.
Also, happy birthday to Melani Evangelista.
And happy birthday wishes to this lovely lady, one of the legends in Guam volleyball coaching, the very beautiful and very young and spry Bobby Canata. Good friend of mine, obviously.
All right, now to your birthday cake winner this week. Congratulations going out to Jonah Diaz. His birthday was this past Monday, so all congratulations.
Right. And enjoy that cake and enjoy what is coming up next. It's a fire.
This captioning is brought to you by IT&E Life in Motion.
Off of day, everybody. Thanks for watching and thanks for streaming us right here on KUAM. We got a good show for you tonight, and we start out with continuing coverage of the fact that this year, as we told you earlier in 2017, is the 70th anniversary of the Sisters of Mercy, and the events continue to show their commitment to the island, their service of their faith, and of the community. Sister Maria Rosario Gaiti is here, as well as Joni Cepeda, representing the Sisters of Mercy, and we are talking about the launch of the Traveling Museum. I cannot wait to hear all about this. So, ladies, off a day, and thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having us.
Okay, Sister, what is the Traveling Museum?
Well, the Traveling Museum is actually part of the 70th anniversary celebration of the Sisters of Mercy. So, it is a traveling, meaning it is traveling from places to places. But we are starting the launch with a celebration at the Cathedral Museum. And there is a small ceremony that will happen tomorrow at 3 o'clock, but it will be open to the public starting this Sunday, February 26th, and it will go on for the next 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. So it'll be open Sunday, Friday, and Saturday.
And let's go ahead and get a shot of that, because I can see that there are many of the significant people in Guam's Catholic experience and documented there. Bishop Bob Gardner, probably the most famous.
Yes.
Yeah. This chronicles and documents, you know, the sisters' correct. Experience
yes.
on Guam.
Yes. Actually, the Traveling Museum is a series of panels that will tell the story of the Sisters of Mercy. So it will feature very rich panels, visually rich panels, as well as artifacts and a timeline and videos about the Sisters of Mercy, highlighting the history, our humble beginnings, our varied ministries, as well as our commitment to the poor, the sick, and the uneducated.
Now, Joni, I'm curious, because when you say traveling, exactly where will this travel to? And, you know, like what's the total route it makes?
It'll be traveling to the different villages, to the different schools. And we hope to also have it at different businesses, as well as the airport and the Guam Museum.
Mm-hmm. So the schools will get to experience this.
Because yes, definitely.
It's, you know, gone are the days when kids would always have these, you know, field trips and everyone would go to get to
correct.
Experience the parts of the island. So this is good that it actually comes to you.
Right. But the beauty of going to the actual museum is you'll see the entire display. Because we are concerned about the delicateness of some of the items that we will be on display, we will only have certain items in certain locations.
Mm-hmm. And when can students expect them to come to like their school? Is there a schedule that's been posted where people can check out?
Actually, we will be coming up with a schedule, and we will be announcing that after the launch.
Oh, very nice.
Yes.
And obviously, this is a wonderful resource for young people to learn about the sisters, and as well as some of the older generations to actually kind of relive some of their history and their
yes,
experiences.
Yes, exactly. And we really are hoping that a lot of our alumni, our co-workers, our friends, and people who have been touched by the Sisters of Mercy will come and view this museum to, in a way, reconnect with the Sisters of Mercy. And at the same time, we're hoping that by viewing this artifacts and display, they'll be inspired. Mm-hmm. They'll be inspired by the Sisters of Mercy's commitment and passion for service and their spirituality, their charism, etc.
And if they are interested in placing the museum in their location, to please give Sister Maria Rosario a call, and so she can schedule them accordingly.
Mm-hmm. Now, Joni, it's interesting we're talking right now, because I was going to say, as long as I've known you, and I've known you very, very long. Mm-hmm. You've actually known me longer than I've been alive.
Yeah, really. Since your mother's womb.
Exactly, yeah. My mom was your teacher when I was, you know, yet to be born, but that's neither here nor there. You've never been someone who shied away from, you know, big logistical planning activities and everything you do for the Academy of Our Lady. How much of a challenge is it to coordinate, you know, a traveling museum? Like you said, like a lot of the artifacts are very, very delicate. Some of them are literally priceless and everything like that. Well, how difficult is it to put this together?
We actually started planning the whole Mercy 70th celebration since October 2015. And I'm very grateful. We have excellent committee chairpersons. So Sister Maria Rosario has taken the lead in the traveling museum. As the overall chair, I just make sure everything is in place. And we discuss monthly on what will be done. But we've asked all the schools to please give whatever artifacts they have. And the convents have been very good in keeping some of their artifacts mm-hmm. and documents. I understand we also have a document from... Was it the original document from Bishop Baumgartner?
Yes, we found a copy of the original letter of Bishop Baumgartner to the Sisters of Mercy, thanking them for, you know, responding to the invitation to start the community
here and again, in 1946. The word priceless just doesn't do justice to the significance of that document to our island community and to the history of the sisters. And mm-hmm. Yeah, yes. It's absolutely amazing you've been able to preserve these artifacts over the years. You know, who curates these?
Well, we do have an archive mm-hmm. for the Sisters of Mercy located at our convent in Mercy Heights in Tamuni.
Okay.
Cool. So by this time around, we were able to, you know, get a few of these items and display to the public to view. So we're excited about that.
Okay. The sisters are very organized, let me tell you.
Absolutely.
And they know how to keep records.
Okay, we got about 15 seconds, so let's close on this. This is obviously is not the only thing going on to commemorate the 70th anniversary of the Sisters of Mercy. What else can we expect this year?
Well, next month we will have a picnic for the homeless on March 18th. Right adjacent to the cathedral grounds, and that'll be an all-day affair. So, and we are working with KUAM Coalition on that. In May, we will be having, on May 6th, we will be having a Mnyahakran, which will be launched by the two nurseries, Mercy Heights and Infant of Prague. And we will also have a shoe slipper drive for those in need. And then in July, we will be part of the Liberation Day celebration. In August, we will start our education seminars. Oh, I forgot. In April, we will be planting trees to address the critical concerns of the earth, of saving the earth. And so planting 70 trees will be symbolic of this.
Well, obviously, this is going to be a very significant year and a very busy year, yes. which again, reinforces your commitment. So we thank you very much.
Bye, but please mark your calendar for November 5th, 2017. That is the highlight. That is the gala event, and that's the final celebration.
And we'll have both of you back many times, you know, as we get closer to that. Yes. Thank you very much.
And thank you for your support.
Thank you.
Please stay tuned. We're back after this.
The strongest teams. Of the strongest fans. We're committed to keeping you close, even when you're not. GTA Strong.
Chuck E. Cheese's Guam is not all fun and games. Our pizza is delicious with the freshest toppings, oven-baked to order. Try the fresh salad bar, sandwiches, and don't forget our mouth-watering wings. Come and eat at Chuck E. Cheese's Guam.
Plus and Mighty, we're celebrating President's Day in a huge way. Nothing says boss like the Ram 1500 for Guam's best truck 2 years in a row. Take up the 4750 off. Or the Jeep Wrangler. Take up the 2500 off. How about the award-winning 2017 Hyundai Accent? Now $12,995. Or the redesigned 2017 Hyundai Elantra. Now $16,995. Visit CarsPlusGuam.com today for quick and easy financing. It's all happening right here at Cars Plus and Mighty. Celebrating President's Day all month long. Cars Plus, driven by you.
House to Home, brought to you by Remax Diamond Realty.
Remax Diamond Realty Guam is in the house, everybody. Liz and Gina are here, and we are talking real estate as we do each and every week. Half a day, ladies.
Half a day. Half a day. Thanks for having us.
Well, you're very welcome. And this week I wanted to talk about something that happens when you buy a new home. There's an inspection that has to happen. Most people, most astute home buyers, will go through property with a fine-tooth comb. I would assume, you know, a lot of people measure for the exact square footage. You know, they check the power, the water, what have you, and everything like that. But there's an official inspection that also has to take place from specialists, as I understand.
Right. Well, in the purchase agreement, normally there's an inspection contingency, which allows the buyer to inspect the home. They can come back a couple of times, and we always recommend you bring an inspector with you. And the buyer has a choice of either doing it themselves. They could bring a friend, a family, an engineer. But then we say, here's a list of licensed inspectors that you would hire to do a thorough inspection of the property. Now, we don't give them one name. We just say, here's a list, you pick and choose. And basically it's for their protection so that later they can start asking the inspector all kinds of questions about different parts of the house. Now, an inspector normally, they charge about $400 to $500 to do an inspection, but they pretty much look at the plumbing, they look at the electrical outlets, is it to code? Are there any deficiency within the home that is not to the government code or a safety issue or a hazard? So those inspectors will point those out and prepare a report for the buyer. And then at that point, the buyer will talk to the seller to say, hey, Mr. Seller, these are deficiencies. Are you willing to handle the problems? Are you willing to do appropriate repairs?
At the price we agreed on, or can I pay for those myself and you just knock the price down?
It's a matter of negotiation. Or if they're buying it in an as-is condition, then that expense would be based on the buyer.
Well, Gina, what's remarkable to me hearing this is that a house might even be put in the market with like some of these deficiencies like already. Like if there's little like tiny quirks in, say, like the wiring or, you know, like the plumbing.
Well, especially with how, and this applies to new homes as well, but especially with older homes, the seller puts it on the market and his mentality is, I'm selling a house, it's already aged. In his mind, he probably realizes, yes, there's maintenance issues, but that's why it's priced the way it is, or maybe not. Some cases, you know, it's not priced, you know, it may not be priced where the buyer thinks it should be priced based on the maintenance issues, but there is that to consider. And the market dictates what happens in terms of pricing. Especially right now, the market has turned very quickly. Last year, we were saying, if you're going to buy, the market's picking up. Well, the market has picked up. Mm-hmm. And so now for buyers that, you know, your question is about sellers. They put it on the market and there's obviously things that need to be done. Sometimes it's a matter of they can't afford to do it. So it's not going to get done. And I've taken that into account when I've priced my home. And for the buyers, the thing to remember is, for instance, maybe the plumbing is not quite right, or there's a little bit of an issue with electrical, or the paint job's not nice, or, you know, the cabinets are aged. But for the price of the home and the location you're looking at, can you find a suitable alternative in that good price range? Or is it easier to buy the house the way it is, negotiate with the seller accordingly, and you do the paint job? Mm-hmm. You change out the toilet bowl later. Because keep in mind, when the inspectors come, their job is to find everything wrong with the house. And then as a buyer, you need to decide, how important is that item to me? So that is it more important that I buy the house, or is it more important that I get a house that has all of these things in perfect condition?
And the seller may be going through unreasonable circumstances, like they're like, hey, I had a family member pass away, or I went through a divorce and everything like that. So I'm selling the house as quickly as possible.
That's right.
It's got some issues with the toilet and everything like that. I'll take $10,000 off if you fix it.
We've had homes where the report comes back and there's maybe 80 items on that list.
Yeah. Wow.
Yes. And because the inspectors are pretty thorough. Now, we've had buyers that will look at it as and would say, hey, that's important, but I can fix that. That's not a problem. So they'll go through the list and then they decide what is important to them. And they may turn around and say, Mr. Seller, I can handle 20 of the items, but I require that you take care of 10 of them. So then at that point, we can talk to both buyer and seller and say, okay, how do we work this? Can we meet somewhere in the middle so that both parties walk away, mm-hmm. you know, happy?
Like, I'll replace the shower heads in the bathroom, but the issues with the water heater, that's on you.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. I think the key element there is that the house meets certain codes for the mm-hmm. government, because if it doesn't and it you can't occupy it, then your loan is in jeopardy. Mm-hmm. The banks won't loan unless it is habitable.
Well, now, real quick, Gina, Liz was saying earlier that, you know, as a prospective buyer, you can go back to the house a couple times, maybe even mm-hmm. three. For people that are planning on doing this, you know, you want to get the most bang for your buck, metaphorically. What should you be planning to do each time when you visit? Should you spend one time just to look at wiring, or one time?
So in a hot market, you may only get one opportunity to look at it before you have to decide.
And who dictates that? How many chances?
Well, the
market does.
Oh, if it sells.
You know, like if I schedule an appointment to go take a look at a house today and I go, and then I decide, you know, I might want to come back over the weekend to see what the neighborhood's like, to take a look at the house again during a different time of day. By the time I get there, what if there's already a contract on the table?
The house gets snapped up.
So yeah, you can go look at it 3, 4, 5 times, but if it's gone, all you're doing is looking at the house.
Because then you get that beautiful sign.
That's right.
That says sold by Liz Duenas.
But remember, the market changes.
So as an agent, if we know it's a hot market and we know the price is right, we would say, hey, you don't want to waste too much time. If you really like it, you can put contingencies in the contract subject to A, B, C, D. And then at that point, you know, you can bow out of the transaction if the contingencies are not satisfied. But as Gina puts it, you're right. If it's a hot market, it'll be snapped up fairly quickly.
You know, if you do sign a contract and you become the buyer who negotiated with the seller successfully and you're pending on that property, remember, you have so many days in your contract to go and inspect mm-hmm. the contingencies. You can go back as many times as you desire mm-hmm. based on availability, of course, if there's somebody living in there based on schedule. But you can go back 4, 5, 10 times. It's up to you.
Okay. Yeah. Well, ladies, thank you for the information. It's interesting how the cliche is known as window shopping, but certainly that may not be the case. So make sure that you maximize your time and the information that they gave you. All right, we're back after this.
Hi, I'm interested in one of your new Samsung devices.
I've got just the one for you.
We opened our online store, upgraded our website, and increased our call center to better serve customers.
Yeah! What do you think?
Solid.
Quarter pounder with cheese, now seared to be thicker and juicier. Only at McDonald's.
Guam's Auto Appearance Specialist, Elegant Reflections, has been providing the automotive industry with professional detailing and car care products at its highest quality, from complete detailing, full interior detailing, exterior detailing, headlamp restoration, hand washing, seat and carpet shampoo, engine degreasing, undercarriage cleaning, paint sealant, fabric protection, paint oxidation removal, and so much more. Visit us at our new location. Call 646-5555 for an appointment. Elegant Reflections, Guam's Auto Appearance Specialist, over 20 years of experience.
All right, my friends, if you've learned one thing in the years that we've been working with Officer Paul Tapao from the Guam Police Department, is that he likes to keep the community safe. And what better way to keep us safe and secure than to arm yourself? And what better way to arm yourself than have an outstanding island athletic talent we have here, Will Stinnett, recently had his jersey retired by FD. And that is an honor, Will. Welcome to Harmon.
Oh, yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you, Paul, for having me. And, you know, thank you guys for having me, too. And it's great to be here and join in on this venture with you guys.
All right. Well, Paul, let's go talk about that, because you're actually partnering with the Elite Basketball Corps, mm-hmm. featuring some of Guam's, you know, most heralded basketball talents, to actually reach out to youth.
Yeah. You know, the program is pretty much dubbed the Fade Away from Violence Basketball Outreach. And what we're doing is we're actually doing something that's very, very new to the island. We reached out to DOE and we asked four schools in particular, two also our partners with the Department of Youth Affairs. And, you know, we're asking for at-risk behavior kids to participate in this. And it's not a forum to punish them or to sit them in those dreaded PowerPoint presentations to the do's and don'ts. We're actually, yes, exactly. So we're actually going to give them something of what we call a healthy alternative lifestyle choice. And what better way to do that than to, you know, incorporate sports, physical activity, and of course, exercise, the game of basketball. And, you know, I was very fortunate to actually team up with Will and the crew at Guam Elite, Guam Elite Basketball, because, you know, when I reached out to the community, I mean, everything was echoed that, you know, you got to get Wilson at on, because majority of our kids are coming from the FAS and the FSM side and everything. And it wasn't done by choice, but it was actually, I think it's a blessing, because, you know, we're actually going to be working with the Crime Stoppers and the Neighborhood Watch to be, you know, reaching out to our kids giving them that opportunity. Mm-hmm. So again, you know, Will and his expertise is going to give the kids an opportunity to learn and participate at its highest level. I mean, where are you going to get that, you know, to be shadowed by, you know, one of Guam City basketball players? I think.
Well, let's find out about that, because Will, you and Dominic and all the guys who are like running the program. I know you guys would agree that, you know, despite our cultural differences, mm-hmm. and, you know, like generational changes that we have, sports is universal, and that's a great way to connect with people.
Definitely. I mean, from a young age, I was raised in Chuuk. Didn't know how to speak English till the fourth grade, so basketball was a tool for me to get mm-hmm. along with everybody. So giving back to the community, come out there, show them that basketball is also like a life teaching tool. Mm-hmm. You'll make friends, you learn how to work together as a team, have a common goal, and, you know, work together to achieve it. So I couldn't be, you know, happier that our organization, Guam Elite, will partner up and help the kids out.
I like the program name too, because fade away from violence.
From violence, yeah.
And your move is actually, is your best move is the step back or the open under?
Yeah, we got everything going to the basket.
It to the hole,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Okay, very cool. Yeah. So how are you guys, what age ranges are you guys working with right now?
Well, we're working primarily with the middle school. This is with the respective four schools that will be participating. We're getting students from FB Leon Guerrero, Benaventi Middle School, Agata Johnson, and Rios Middle School, to include clients too from Department of Youth Affairs. Mm-hmm. Now, this is, like I said, this is the first of many to come. So, you know, we're pretty much gauging everything on what will work and what's not going to work. Hopefully, everything that we put out is going to work for the kids, because, again, we're not putting the kids in an environment where we're going to bore them to death. And we want to give them an activity in which, you know, like what Will said, you know, I mean, it's the best way to engage and to make friends. And, you know, we want them to have that team bonding, that team experience. And, you know, speaking with him, you know, I'm a coach too in soccer, and we all have the same coaching philosophy, and we always want to instill life skills with these kids. And, you know, I mean, I've seen testimony, because I have his kids also playing soccer, so they talk highly of their program. And, you know, it only reflects the coaches in which they are.
I want to talk some more with Wilson about this wonderful program with Guam Elite Basketball. Now, you and Paul are both household names at this point, because, you know, kids coming up, you know, they look up to you guys. They know, Paul, what you've done in the community, mm-hmm. what you do with athletics. And Will, you know, a lot of people admire you for the fact that, you know, you've now, like I said, you've had your number retired. You do great things for the FD basketball community. You've played internationally. You've done things for the Guam national team and everything like that. What message can you give to young people about, you know, if you work hard, if, like you said, you play as a team, you make friends, you do things right?
I mean, just instilling a work ethic, I think, especially it starts at a young age. Practice, just skills. So from our academy, we're 18 weeks in with the kids now, and ages from 6 to 18, they practice twice a week, and we just, you know, give them assignments, basic skills and drills to do, and it's been a success. Parents love it, and it's just good to give back to the community. I'm to the point in my career where I want to give back to the kids, and I want to see them do better than me or do
Come
better
on, Will,
than
you're
me
not that old, man. You still got game in you.
A little bit. I got a few more good years left.
You can still play above the rim.
Yep, I can get up there, yeah.
I know both of you would agree that there is no I in team, and it's all about working together.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, the team concept, no matter what sport you play, whether it's on the court or on the pitch, you know, as coaches, we emphasize that. You work, the work ethic, you drive it home and everything to these kids that practice makes perfect. You know, you practice what you play, and you play what you practice, and you instill that in the kids. And it all starts with, you know, your coach's philosophy. But I heard testimony from my kids who are now venturing into soccer about their program, and I continue to encourage them. because these are the life skills that they're going to learn. And again, my brother, thank you so much. Thank you. On behalf of the Guam Police Department, the Crime Stoppers, you know, we're really excited for this program. Be looking out for more to come. You know, we're going to reach out to all the schools. And like I said, March 2nd and 3rd, the Guam Sports Complex, something new, something, innovative for our attitude.
All right. Thanks so much, guys. We appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for having us, man.
Community Calendar is brought to you by Taco Bell. Whether it's your first meal or your fourth meal, we've got you covered. Taco Bell, live mas.
Smiling is a natural response to joy, happiness, and excitement. Your smile reveals a lot about who you are. A healthy, beautiful smile can brighten your appearance and be an invitation to conversation and friendship. It is often one of the first things people notice about you. Now, thanks to the advancements in dentistry, you can have the smile you have always wanted, giving you an improved smile that looks and feels great.
My silver fillings that I have, they're getting older in my mouth and I need to replace them. So I've started to do that and I've replaced them with the white fillings and I've had really great success with that. It looks good, they feel natural, and it kind of goes hand in hand with the bleaching. I want a white look all around my mouth.
All right, everybody, it is time for Tourism Works. And tonight I want to introduce you to my friend Dominic, who best exemplifies what we have here on Guam as island hospitality. And as you'll now see, he practices what he preaches.
Tourism Works, brought to you by the Guam Visitors Bureau.
So good afternoon, welcome to Guam.
Hello, for you guys. My name is Dominic Santos Flores. I work for Pearl Restaurant Tumon. And my job title is Food and Beverage Hospitality.
Julia for three. Julia.
I am involved with the tourism industry because of the tourists. They really hear about our really good barbecue menu. We have excellent desserts. And we also always put a smile on our face. We're always positive, no matter how busy it gets. The most gratifying part of our job is breaking that stranger shy ice. Like when they come in through the door, how are you guys, you know, how are you doing today? And they're like, you know, kind of like shy, you know, they don't know what to do. And then you go up to them and say, are you for two? And it's like, and they're like, yes, this is your first time? And I said, yes. And oh, great, first time is the best part. Tourism works for me because it makes me come into work every day meeting different people from Japan, from Korea, Russia, Australia, and also helps me work on my social skills. It makes me be brave, not only at work, but anywhere you go. Like when you're greeting someone that's like in a bad mood or they're having a sad day, and you just greet them by saying, you know, how are you doing today? You know? Tourism in Guam allows our business to thrive because majority of our guests are tourists. You see behind me, and just welcoming them with our good spirit and positive vibe, sharing our good local food that they don't get off island and stuff. And then from there on, I would give like our business is networking by
also by sharing. I even give them my Facebook, you know, email address, and we contact and talk about our life. And then we tell them you should come back anytime, you know, we're here to help you. And basically, that's what makes our business thrive. We should support tourism and our visitors because they're the ones supporting our economy, and also continue to be welcoming, generous, and giving, because from there on, you also develop relationships and friendships with them, and they will come back looking for you and saying, oh, nice to see you again. I'm Dominic Flores, I'm from Pearl Restaurant, and tourism works for me.
Tourism works, brought to you by the Guam Visitors Bureau. Closed captioning is brought to you by IT&E Life in Motion.